Good evening, everyone. Hello, hello. Good evening. Good evening. Can I get everyone's attention? Thank you so much for coming to our evening refocus meeting. Did you guys have a restful Sabbath this so far? Yes, yes, yes. Sabbath is one of the best days of the week for me. It allows me just to be human, you know, just to hang out with friends, to hang out with other brothers and sisters in Christ. And I don't know about you, but I was blessed not only by yesterday evening's message, but this morning's message as well. Amen. And it's truly a message that is not only difficult to communicate, but also a message that requires a level of spiritual maturity. But now more than ever, I believe that it's so important for us to really get right with God and to refocus on what really matters most, and that is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And so before Dr. Machado speaks, if you don't know, again, Dr. Machado is a son of God. He has seen God work in amazing ways in our world church, and he currently serves the Lord as the Florida Conference president. I'm sure all you guys have gotten to be familiar with him as you've heard him speak. But before we start, I'd like to open this program with a word of prayer. So please join me as we pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much that as we see the sun setting, that you've given us this time to rest, to be human, to breathe, to be still, and know that you are God. Lord, I thank you for reminding us that with you we can endure all things, that we can learn to be content with what we have in you and who we are in you. And Lord, that we can also have faith and understand that all things work together for good for those whom you love and that we love you, Father. Amen. And God, whatever message Dr. Machado has tonight, the message that you have given him, Lord, may the same spirit that lives in Jesus, may the same spirit that resurrected him from the dead abide in us this evening. Amen. So that, Lord, we're able to learn, to hear, and to respond. I pray this in your name.
Amen. Amen. Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for being here with me today. It was such a beautiful Sabbath. Such a wonderful Sabbath. Thank you for praying for me. Thank you for approaching me and telling me about you and the things that you're going through. Someone mentioned this morning, Pastor, I'm going through a lot of situations, difficulties in my life. I want you to pray for me, and I want you to know that I'll be praying for you. If you have anything specific that you want me to pray for after the meeting this afternoon, we can pray together. All right? I also want to say that I will not waste the opportunity of being here this weekend and next weekend to say that it is important that if there's someone that is willing to surrender his or her life to Jesus. We Christians believe that there is a lot of blessing by surrendering our lives to God. Amen. And we believe in baptism. You know what that means? That you're going to symbolically die to your old self to be what? To be born again. If there's anyone that is willing to be baptized and to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, you can talk to me or you can talk to Pastor Garcia, and we'll study the Bible with you, or we'll answer your questions, because I believe that God wants you to be part of His family, the family of God. So think about it. It is just a beautiful experience just to be able to say, yes, I want to die to my old self and I want to be born again. And we believe that in that moment the Holy Spirit and the power of God will come upon you and your life will be transformed. It doesn't mean that you're not going to have challenges from that moment on. It means that now you belong to God and that Jesus is your Lord and Savior. So talk to me. Talk to Pastor Garcia or Pastor Jones next weekend. I think it'll be his last weekend with us. I think that's accurate. Anyways, I'll be around and I'll be available if you want to talk to me about that. We had a wonderful meeting with the other pastors that are preaching in the other churches in the area. So we have at least 10 churches that are participating. And I was blessed to be assigned to come here. So I feel part of the family already. You have been so wonderful to me. Thank you. Thank you. So we were talking. I want you to know that this is the first attempt to do evangelism in a year and a half, maybe more. This is the first time since March 2020, last year, that we are trying, right? We're trying to bring the Word of God to those that are in need. And there are so many people in need right now. So many people in need, looking for answers, looking for God, looking for forgiveness, looking for restoration and reconciliation with God. So many. So we decided to continue with a plan. And praise the Lord. We were listening to the testimonies of the other pastors, and it's been a blessing everywhere. So thank you. Thank you for sticking to the plan, right? Even during difficult times. I want to talk to you today about a new commandment. So think about Jesus having the Last Supper with his disciples. You can read about it in John 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. It's the longest conversation that you find in the Gospels. Jesus is having that dinner with them the day before his crucifixion. He knows that he will have to offer his life as a sacrifice for the world the following day. He knew it. And he's talking to his disciples. And I can only imagine the things that Jesus is thinking. What do I share with them during this Last Supper? I have so much to share. As a matter of fact, he said, in that conversation, he said, I have so much to share with you, but you will not understand all the things that I would like to tell you. But the Holy Spirit will be provided for you. I have to go. And you're not going to be able to come with me. And the disciples were asking the question, but where are you going? How can we go back to the Father? He talked about his second coming. He talked about the Holy Spirit. He talked about persecution. He talked about his sacrifice. I will be given to bad people. And I will be betrayed. And the disciples are listening to all of that. I imagine that he was speaking for hours. Again, it's the longest conversation recorded in the four Gospels. John 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. He shared parables. He shared, I'm going back to the Father. And in that conversation, out of the blue, Jesus says, I have a new commandment for you. Now think about this. Those that were there listening to Jesus, they knew the Torah, the Mishnah and the Talmud by memory. They were taught the Talmud and the Mishnah since they were little children. As a matter of fact, it was the mother that was responsible for teaching the children how to memorize the Torah, the 633 commandments. And they're listening to Jesus. And now Jesus is saying, I have a new commandment for you. And I imagine that they stop eating and they kind of, wait a minute, something is going to happen here. Our teacher is about to change the prophets and the law. Something that was a surprise for Jews. The prophets and the law. He is giving us a new commandment. And they stopped eating and they looked at each other and said, what would that be? How is our teacher, our rabbi, how is he going to change our traditions, our laws, the Torah? Imagine that. And then Jesus says, I am going to give you a new commandment. And this is the commandment. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one, what? Another. And I can imagine the disciples breathing like, ah, praise the Lord, Elohim. He didn't change the prophets and the law. Why? This is very old. It goes back to Moses. It goes back to Leviticus 19. It goes back to Deuteronomy chapter 6. This is a concept that all the disciples that were there around the table, they didn't have a table. They would eat on the floor. I'm sure you know that. They would be lying on the floor, kind of lying on top of another, and that's the way they had that Last Supper. And it was kind of a relief, you know. Our rabbi did not change the prophets and the law. This is a very old. How is it possible that our rabbi is saying, I'm going to give you a new commandment? There's nothing new about this. Nothing new about this. Leviticus 19, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There it is. On another occasion, when the Pharisees asked Jesus what the great commandment was, Jesus answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And then Jesus says, the second is similar, that you love one another. There was nothing new about that. This postulate of loving one another was a premise known to all Israelites since God gave the Torah to Moses in the wilderness. There was nothing new in this concept. The scribes and Pharisees taught this commandment in all the synagogues, and you find it in the Talmud, which is the interpretation of the Torah by the Jewish people that went to Babylon, and you find it in the Mishnah, and that is the interpretation of the Torah of the Jews that went to Alexandria with Jeremiah, after the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem. It was there. It was there. It was analyzed and discussed for centuries. And now Jesus is saying that he's given them, us, a new commandment. Why does Jesus call this a new commandment, is the question. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. And here is the new thing. As I what? This is the new thing. This is what changed everything. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I love you. That's the new thing. Now, for Christians, that's a huge endeavor. Because as human beings, we don't necessarily love as Jesus loves. I would submit to you that this is a change of paradigm. This is a change of the premise. The new commandment is that we love one another as Jesus loved us and loves us. This new revolutionary commandment takes us to a new level. And Jesus is saying, and you will be known when you learn to love one another as I love you. The Christian church is known for loving one another as Jesus loves. I want to submit to you that sometimes we have failed in loving others the same way that Jesus loves. Ellen G. White wrote it this way: you have given the people the rich treasures of God's word, but your manner has been so condemnatory that they have turned from them. You have not taught the truth in the way that Christ taught it. You present it in a way that ruins, mars its influence. Your heart needs to be filled with the love and grace of Christ. Why do I bring this to you? Because we're trying to refocus our relationship with the Lord. Sometimes we have to confess that we share the good news of salvation in a way that is condemnatory. And we tried to infuse or to push our beliefs on people in a way that ruins the influence of the truth. Think about how do we share the gospel with those that are lost, those that are in need of Jesus and the love of God. I would submit to you that sometimes when we are exposed to people that don't think like we think, that don't do the things that we do, that don't eat the way we eat, that they don't have the same traditions and ways of the way that we do things, we don't feel comfortable with them. And Jesus is saying, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I love you. Let me clarify this concept a little more. Ellen G. White clarifies it for us. The sacrifice of Christ as an atonement for sin is the great truth. Is what? Is what? The great truth. The sacrifice of Christ as an atonement for sin is the great truth around which all other truths, what? Cluster. Sometimes, as Adventists, we're sharing doctrine and truth, and we believe that we're sharing the gospel. As a matter of fact, we're not. Sometimes we share the truth of the Sabbath as the great truth, but that's not what she's saying in there. So the truth is Christ and his sacrifice. Everything else, the Sabbath, sanctuary, all the truth, 28 doctrines that we preach, everything that we preach needs to be understood through the cross of Calvary. Let me read it to you, around which all the truth cluster, in order to be rightly understood and appreciated. Every truth in the Word of God, from Genesis to Revelation, must be studied in the light that streams from what? The cross of Calvary. So if we're teaching about the Sabbath, if you take Jesus out of the Sabbath, what do you have? What do you have? You know what the Pharisees had? They had 135 norms or traditions regarding the Sabbath. None of them had to do with our Lord Jesus Christ. 135. So, for example, you could not go to the well and bring water back home. You needed to count the steps on the Sabbath day. You needed to do so many things. 135 norms. Remember the story about the paralytic that Jesus healed on a Sabbath day, and he said, stand up, pick up your what? Your mat and go home. What happened? As soon as he turned the corner with his bed under his arm, he was approached by whom? By Pharisees. Why are you carrying your bed on the Sabbath day? Don't you know that you cannot do that? And he answered, I don't know. All I know is that I was sick and paralytic for 38 days. I mean, years. 38 years. And the person who healed me said, pick up your mat and go home. That's all I know. So if he was able to heal me after 38 years, at the pool of Bethesda, over there waiting for the water to move. He had the power to heal me after 38 years of being there, he also has the power to tell me what to do. Pick up your bed and go home. Amen. You see, sometimes we lose sight of what is important and we emphasize what it is in the periphery. And God wants us to put Jesus in the center. Is the great truth around which all other truth cluster. Ellen G. White said, I present before you the great grand monument of mercy and regeneration, salvation and redemption, the Son of God uplifted on the cross. This is to be the foundation of every Bible study, every sermon, every discourse, every song we sing, everything we do. The Son of God uplifted on the cross should be the foundation of everything we do. Given by our ministers. I read this story about love and how we should love one another. A few years ago at the Seattle Olympics, also called Special Olympics, 9 participants, this is a true story, all mentally disabled, line up for the start of the 100-meter race. At the signal, everyone left, not exactly fast, but with a desire to give their best, finish a race, and win the prize. All but one boy, who stumbled on the floor, fell and rolled and began to cry. The other 8 heard the cry, slowed down and looked back. They saw the boy on the ground. They stopped and they returned. All of them. All of them. One of the girls with Down syndrome knelt down, kissed the boy, and said, ready, now you're going to win. And all the 9 competitors hold hands and walk together to the finish line. The whole stadium stood up with tears in their eyes. The applause lasted 10 long minutes. The people who were there that day had never forgotten the story. And here is a picture of all the competitors winning the race. This is the way Jesus loves. You don't leave anyone behind. You don't look down on anyone. We do it together. In the same way in the Christian life, when you win, we all win. When one of us overcomes temptation, we all win. When a marriage is reconciled and home is saved, we all win. When you help me to keep my children in the way of the Lord, we all win. When we learn to love one another, we all win. Sometimes we say we love, but we don't know what we're saying. Because love should never be painful. The love of God redeems, transforms, forgives. Sometimes we love, but that love is nothing but a distorted way. We say to the other person, I love you, but we don't know how to love. So a new commandment is given to us by Jesus. That we love one another, not as we know how to love, but as what? Jesus loves. Now the question is, how do we love? It makes a difference in a Christian life. How do you identify a true believer of Jesus when one that says he is and is nothing but leaves, says the Lord? How are we known in the world? Jesus answered the question, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples if you what? Love one another. Christians make the difference in the world not when they talk, but when they bear fruit. Let me try to make a distinction between the way we love and the way God loves. I would suggest to you that humans love conditionally. What is the meaning of that? That we love those that love back? You understand what I'm saying? That we love those that think like we think and look like we look and eat what we eat. They are the same status of, you know, it is so complicated the way we love. I remember this couple came to me looking for help because they were struggling in their marriage, and I said, how can I help you? And she says, well, Pastor, my husband, and she started talking about her husband in a way that I'm saying, what is this? And then she says something like this, and I'm telling you all this, Pastor, because I love him. And then he comes back and he says, no, Pastor, you don't know how it is. She is like this and like that, and you know, and she's, you know, and then he says, I'm telling you all this because I love her. And I'm thinking, what kind of a love is this? You see? Learning to love like Jesus takes intentionality. You really have to surrender your life to Him. You really need to allow the love of God to transform your heart. It is not about winning a fight or a discussion or an argument. You know, in eternity, we're not going to have time to think about that. Sometimes we open the Bible and we try to teach the beautiful truth of the Bible, but we do it in a way that is distorted. If I ask you to guess how many Christians were there at the end of the first century, we're talking about around the year 100. You know, the Gospel of John was the last document that was written in the Bible. We believe that the Gospel of John was written about year 95, right? So a lot of people believe that Revelation was the last document that was written. It was the Gospel of John, year 95. So around the time John the Apostle was writing or dictating or sharing the gospel to the one that is writing, around that time, how many Christians do you think were there around that year? And the answer is there. Scholars estimate that there were around how many Christians in the known world? 25,000 Christians. So remember, the Church of Christ began with Jesus and 11 disciples. And then Paul was added as another disciple and evangelist. And from there, from Jerusalem, the church started growing into Asia Minor and other places. And it is estimated that by the end of the first century, there were 25,000 Christians in the known world. Now, let me ask you this question. How many Christians were there at the beginning of the fourth century? I'm going to give you a specific date, around 310 AD. And I'm being specific about that date because something happened that year, 310, that tells us more or less how many Christians were there in the known world around 200 years after, right, this number here, 25,000 Christians. How many Christians do you think were there around the year 3, at the beginning of the 4th century? So the Council of Nicaea happened in 325. You know that, right? So before that, how many Christians were there in the known world? Any guess? So at the end of the 1st century, 25,000. At the beginning of the 4th century, year 310, more or less, how many Christians were there in the known world?
2,000.
I'm sorry, I don't hear well. Yes, you're going to find the answer in this book, The Forgotten Ways, by Allan Hirsch. It's an amazing book. You should read it. It's good. So I found the documentation there. So I'll give you the answer. After extensive studies, scholars have come to the conclusion that by the year 300 AD, there were more than 20 million Christians in the known world. Now, the question is, how did they go from 25,000 Christians at the end of the first century to 20 million Christians 200 years later? But before you answer the question, let me share this with you. The church was illegal through this period. As a matter of fact, if you were found to be a Christian, you were put to death. It was not easy to be a Christian. How they did it? They had no buildings or temples as we know them today. They did not have the Bible as we know it today. They did not have the Bible. There were no institutions or professionally trained pastors. They had no seminaries to send our pastors. There were no religious services like the ones we enjoy today. There were no conferences or unions or divisions. There was no general conference. Specialized services as youth departments, stewardship department, evangelism department, children and families, women's ministry, men's ministry, pathfinders, none of that. There were no worship teams, no seminars, electronic libraries with interlinear and commentaries. And I add, it was really difficult to be a Christian in those days. You would end up in a circus, in a Roman circus, eaten by animals. How did the church go from 25,000 Christians running, hiding, to 20 million Christians in 200 years without organized churches and denominations and the Bible and libraries and professionally trained pastors? How? What did they have that we need today? Yes, that's the answer. That's the answer. They had everything in common. No one went hungry. No one was put aside. Christians loved each other the way Jesus loved them. And they had the power of the Holy Spirit. That is the answer to the question. How the church was able to multiply from a small group into millions of Christians under very difficult circumstances. I said the year 310 for one reason. There is a document that I invite you to read. You can Google it, you can find it. It's the letter to Dionetus. Dionetus is a Roman official that was inquiring about these people that called themselves Christians. There are so many of them. And the more we kill, the more we find. Who are these people? What are they doing? What do they believe? And this letter is an anonymous letter sent to Dionetus around the year 310, at the beginning of the 4th century, describing a strange people who are in the world but are not of the world. Do you want me to read just a couple of paragraphs? Now listen to the description of this writer giving a report to Dionysius, inquiring about Christians. He says, those who call themselves disciples of Christ are not different from the people because they are from another country or language or customs. Let me say that again. The church was very diverse back then. They are not different from the people because they are from another country or language or customs. You see, Dionetus, he wrote, they do not live in city only for Christians. They do not speak a strange language. They live in all cities. They follow the local customs of dress, food, and other aspects of life. But at the same time, they demonstrate the unusual form of their own citizenship. Christians marry and have children like everyone else, but they do not abandon their children. This is the description. They offer to share the table, but they do not share their bed. They spend their days on earth, but they are citizens of heaven. They obey the laws, but they go beyond them in their own lives. Christians love all people. This is a person that is given a report about Christians that are being persecuted, put to death. And he's saying, this is why they multiply. They love all people. They are persecuted by all. They are brought to death and reach life. They are poor, and at the same time, they make others rich. They are dishonored and thus gain glory. Their names are blurred, and at the same time, they are glorified. When people laugh at them, they bless. They are treated with cruelty and show respect to their executioners. When they do good, they are punished for blasphemers. When they are punished, they rejoice as if they are being given new life. They are attacked by the Romans as dogs, by the Jews as members of a strange sect, and by the Greeks as lacking in understanding. And yet, Dionetus, those who hate them cannot give any reason for their hatred. And even if they don't recognize it, they would like to be like them and try to imitate them. Wow. My message to you tonight is simple yet profound. We are called to love one another as Jesus loves. And now I'll tell you about the love of God. The love of God is unconditional. Unconditional. That means that He loves you even though you and I don't deserve it. Can you imagine that? He is patient with you and with me even though we are not patient with Him. He is there for us even when we don't want God to be there for us. He has never betrayed us, forsaken us. He has never abandoned us. He has been there for us. You know why? Because it cost Jesus His life. That's how much God loves us. He was willing to give Himself, to give His life to save us. So I want to finish before we sing Amazing Grace. I want to read how Paul describes the love of God for us. And he says, in your relationships, this is the letter to the Philippians, chapter 2, verse 5. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is what? Is Lord. in your relationships with one another, have the mind of Jesus. God bless you tonight. That is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Sometimes we remain on the periphery and we emphasize a lot of things that are not necessarily relevant to our relationship with the Lord and with one another. Let us learn to love like Jesus. Let us learn to love one another like Jesus loves. God bless you tonight. My appeal to you tonight is allow the love of God to conquer your heart. Imagine that. God decided after the temple was destroyed that he would dwell in your heart, that he would place his throne in your heart. Allow the love of God to conquer your life, your heart, your mind. And let us love like Jesus loves. How many of you would say, I want to love like Jesus loves? Amen. I want to represent Jesus in everything I do, everything I say. I want to be an ambassador of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. God bless you tonight. Let us sing together. Then we pray. I'm driving back to Orlando tonight. I have meetings tomorrow. But I will be here on Friday, 7 p.m. And we will continue studying the Word of God. They are walking next to the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus turns to Peter and says, Peter, do you love me? And he says, I love you. Now, if you read Greek, you would understand a dynamic there that is impressive. Jesus is using the word agapao, that means unconditional love. Peter is responding with the word phileo, that means love among friends. So Jesus is asking Peter, Peter, do you agapao me? Do you love me unconditionally? And Peter is saying, I love you as a friend. Jesus asked the question again, and he says, Peter, do you agapao me? Peter says, you know, I phileo you. Third time, Jesus says to Peter, Peter, do you love me? And Peter says, Lord, you know everything. You know that I agapao you. He got it the third time. You know that I love you unconditionally. And then Jesus said, go and shepherd my flock. We cannot shepherd the flock of God if we don't know to agapao Jesus. And that means unconditionally, unconditional love. May the Lord bless you tonight. That is a church that God wants to build before the second coming of Jesus. When Jesus comes, what kind of a church we should be? We will be known in the world because we have learned to love one another. I submit to you, nothing else will be a distinction but the unconditional love of Jesus being represented in our lives. If you need prayer, we're going to pray for you. And if you need to start your walk with Jesus again, this is the week. And if you decide that you want to make Jesus the center of your life, your Savior, your Lord, maybe this week you want to be baptized. I don't know if we have anyone here that is willing to say yes, but we're going to be praying for you. And I'm going to be calling because the Lord called me to call. I'm a tool of God's hands. Nothing more. The Holy Spirit is the one that convinces, touches the heart, and transforms. My responsibility is to call. If there's anyone here tonight that wants to surrender his life or her life to Jesus, maybe tonight is the night. God bless you. I love you. Pray for me. I will continue praying for you. All right, let us pray together. Father, we love you. We love you, Lord. We want to say tonight that we agapao you. We love you unconditionally, the same way that you love us. Father, we surrender our hearts to you. And we say tonight, we want to be obedient to your commandments, especially the very old commandment that we must love one another. Now in a new way, in a revolutionary way, like Jesus loves us. So Father, we ask you, Lord, to forgive us of all of our sins and trespasses. We ask you, Lord, that you give us a new nature, new life, a new beginning. We ask you, Lord, that from now on, we represent Jesus in everything we do, everything we say, in every act, in every way. We want to represent the kingdom of God everywhere we are. Bless your church, Lord. We ask, we implore for healing. There are so many of your children that are sick. Touch them, Lord. Heal them. There are so many families that are hurt. Heal them, Lord. There are so many people that are lost in the world looking for salvation and love. May we are able to show them your love in our lives, in everything we are in Jesus. Give us a good week. Thank you for this wonderful Sabbath that you have given us. Thank you, Father. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.